Well, today's lecture is on SAR interferometry. So here in this class, we will be exploring the potential of SAR interferogram for displacement mapping and the elevation information retrieval of our surface. So SAR interferometry basically deals with the interferogram generation of two SAR imageries. From the first figure, the background figure, we can see there are two satellites to capture the SAR images, and finally we can see the fringes. Interferograms are basically generation of or set of constructive and destructive fringes. So on the basis of that, we will be able to extract the information of the phase difference. So finally, using the different techniques on the basis of the phase difference of SAR interferogram, one will be able to extract the information of displacement and elevation information. So we will start with electromagnetic radiation. So electromagnetic radiation consists of an electrical field E, which varies in magnitude in a direction perpendicular to the direction in which the radiation is traveling, and a magnetic field M oriented at right angles to the electrical field. Both these fields travel at the speed of light. Electromagnetic radiation consists of an electric field vector E vector, which varies in magnitude in a direction perpendicular to the direction in which the radiation is traveling, and a magnetic field M oriented at right angles to the electric field. Both these fields travel at the speed of light. Here we can see C is the direction of propagation of electromagnetic wave, E is the direction of vibration of electric field vector, and M is representing the direction of vibration of the magnetic field vector, and both are mutually perpendicular and perpendicular to the direction of propagation of electromagnetic wave. Now, there are few terms which are used in remote sensing, particularly SAR remote sensing. So first term is phase. The phase of an oscillation or wave is the fraction of complete cycle corresponding to an offset in the displacement from a specified reference point at time t equals to 0. Now, if we will be considering the starting time phase of electromagnetic wave at the time of generation or at the time of start, so here we can see at the origin, if you will see, here the phase will be 0 if you will see the cursor. This is the origin. Here phase will be 0, and at the maximum peak the phase will be 90 degree. So if you will see at that the generation of electromagnetic wave, at the time of generation of electromagnetic wave or at the time of transmit of electromagnetic wave, phase is in between 0 to pi by 2. And if any object is appearing during the electromagnetic interaction of the electromagnetic wave, so suppose this is appearing at any location, for example, say it is appearing at this location, so definitely the, its phase will be approximately near to here it will be pi by 2, then here it will be pi, here it will be 3 pi by 2, here it will be 2 pi, so approximately near to 2 pi. So by counting the number of cycles, one will be able to find out the phase of electromagnetic wave at the time of interaction of any object on the Earth's surface or any other feature. One will be able to find out the information of phase of electromagnetic wave. Amplitude and wavelength. The wavelength is the length of one wave cycle, which can be measured as a distance between two successive wave crests. Wavelength is usually represented by the Greek letters lambda. So if you will see, there are two crests, so two successive crests. If you will see, the distance between the two successive crests will be known as wavelength. Now, the amplitude of wave is defined as the maximum disturbance from the equilibrium. If you will see this horizontal line, this is the, we can say, the point of equilibrium, and A is representing the maximum disturbance in the electromagnetic wave. So this height will be known as the amplitude of the electromagnetic wave. So the amplitude of the wave is measured as the height from the equilibrium point to the highest point of a crest, or the depth from the equilibrium point to the lowest point of a trough. Here in SAR interferometry, we are talking about the interference of electromagnetic wave. A radio wave, light, sound, or water ripples have the property of wave, And when more than one wave of the same kind meet at the same point, each wave will intensify each other or cancel each other. Due to interaction of waves, such a phenomena is commonly called interference. Now, when the interference will be in such a way that the final product will be the will be providing the inset intensified result, then that will be the constructive interference. And when they will be canceling each other, so finally no information will be there, that will be known as a destructive interference. So here you can see, if you will see the here if you will see m equals to 0, this is representing the central point of fringe, or we can say the central fringe. So red points are representing the constructive interference and blue are representing the destructive interference, because here you can simply see the thicker line is representing the crest and the thinner line representing the trough. So where crest and trough will be meeting, then there will be they will be canceling each other. So they will be canceling each other, so no information will be there. Finally, that will be a type of destructive interference. And you can see here, like for m equals to 0, the two thicker lines or two lines are interfering, and finally that will be a kind of constructive interference. So both the waves are originated from two sources, S1 and S2. Here these are the S1 and S2, these are the coherent source of electromagnetic waves. So electromagnetic waves are originated from these sources, and finally these waves will be propagating, and there will be a pattern of interference. We will be able to get the interferometric fringes. So the interferometric fringes will be either constructive or destructive. So here you can see the red points are the position of constructive interference and blue points are the example of the destructive interference. Now, wave theory of nature. First, this was postulated by the scientist Young, and this is the very famous experiment, Young's double slit experiment. So in that experiment, light source is emitting the light electromagnetic waves, and finally there are two holes in an aperture, so that they will be behaving like the secondary source of the electromagnetic wave. And finally, from both the holes, electromagnetic waves will be, from both the secondary sources, electromagnetic waves will be illuminated and are transmitted. And finally, again, they will be generating constructive and destructive patterns. Here, from the top figure, if you will see, here, this is a type of destructive interference, because trough and crest both are cancelling each other. So finally here, we will be getting the dark patches, and here trough and crest both are intensify each other. So finally at these locations we will be getting the bright patches. And these are known as the destructive and the constructive interferences. We can directly correlate this Young's double slit experiment with our SAR interferometry. In SAR interferometry, there must be two SAR images. Either they will be collected by two SAR sensors in bistatic mode, or one SAR sensor in the repeat pass mode, and the distance between this slit can be compared with the baseline of the SAR system, SAR platforms. So finally, this is SAR interferometry is an simple extension of Young's double slit experiment only. Now, when we will see on the screen where the interference pattern will occur, so finally we will be getting the dark and bright patterns. Dark fringes will be representing no information. Finally, destructive interference. Bright fringes will be representing the constructive interference. here we can understand for constructive interference, the path difference must be zero or an integral multiple of the wavelength. This is the very simple formula I used to know the constructive interference and its location. So one can easily find out. Now here we will understand the phenomena. Suppose this is the electromagnetic wave generated from one source and our first source, and this is the electromagnetic wave of the same amplitude generated by the second source. So here, since both are propagating in the same direction, so finally after interference both will be intensifying, and they will be giving a very high intensity in comparison to the individual ones. Here we can easily see both are merged and finally providing a very high intensity. Now same will happen with the these are the crests, and same will happen with the trough also. Both will be providing, since both are propagating in the same direction, and finally both are vibrating in the same direction, and finally if they will interfere, they will intensify each other, and finally providing very high intensity. Now in the case of destructive interference, so for destructive interference, the path difference be an odd multiple of half wavelength. So we can understand the interference pattern with the help of this figure. So before interference, the red one is representing the electromagnetic wave illuminated or transmitted by the first source, and blue is representing the electromagnetic wave transmitted by the second source. So finally, when they will interfere, so finally there will be cancellation, and we will be getting very low intensity. Finally, there will be destructive interference. They will cancel each other, and dark spot will be obtained on the opposite side of the screen. And here also we can understand the phenomena. If you will see from this source, electromagnetic waves is transmitted, and again from the second source the same electromagnetic wave is transmitted, and there will be a path difference also. So here, because electromagnetic waves are interfering each other, or there is an interference pattern in the way of destructive interference, so finally there will be dark fringes, because both the fringes or both the electromagnetic waves will cancel each other. Now if you will see here, both the electromagnetic waves are vibrating in the same direction, and finally they will intensify each other, and we will be getting the bright pattern that will be kind of constructive interference. Suppose C is representing the central fringe. We will be getting the fringes like that, and definitely there will be distance. Fringes will be separated by one amount. Suppose this distance is X. So one can easily measure the distance of any fringe from the central fringe. Suppose lambda is the wavelength of the electromagnetic wave in meters, and X is distance from the central fringe, D is distance between the slit, this distance is D, and N is the order of the fringe, L is equals to length from the screen with the slide. So here L we can consider in the SAR interferometry, this L as range distance, mean range distance, means the distance from sensor to the object. Finally, one can easily find out the distance of the fringe from the central fringe. So suppose we are measuring the distance of this fringe, n equals to 2, from the central fringe, n equals to 0. So this distance can be easily measured using this formula, n multiplied by L, and again multiplication with the wavelength divided by the distance, or you can say the distance between the source, distance between S1 and S2. And now the phase at point P, suppose the phase at this point, that will be equals to 2 pi d sine theta by lambda. If you will see the phase information of interferometric pattern on the screen, then it will be ranging from minus pi to pi. So here we can see, so without intensity, and if one will trying to extract any information with the help of phase only, then there will be no use of phase. But definitely for interferometric application to extract the information of any object related to its height and displacement, definitely one will be in need of the phase information. Now, from the previous figure, here we can correlate it with the two SAR sensors collecting the SAR images, because in SAR interferometry we will be utilizing the two SAR images. Now, SAR interferometry is simple extension of Young's interferometry concept, so that we have already discussed the Young's interferometry concept. Now, SAR image is equivalent to a phase and amplitude detector. Now, in the Young's double slit experiment, the two sources of the electromagnetic waves or two sources of light should be the coherent. So here the two SAR antenna act as coherent point sources. So two SAR images can be used to generate interferogram. Now here if you will see, the interferometric phase will vary from minus pi to plus pi. Here SAR 1 is representing the location of SAR sensor at the time of first acquisition or for the first image, and the SAR 2 is representing the position or location of the platform during second acquisition. It might be possible to do the SAR interferometry at the same time using bistatic mode, or it is also possible to do the SAR interferometry using repeat pass. Repeat pass is the pass when SAR sensor will come after a certain time of period at the same location, and with the same geometric configuration it will collect the image for the same area. SAR interferometry, it is extremely difficult to measure the distance to the reflecting object by counting the numbers of peaks and the troughs of the radio wave. So definitely by counting the number of peaks and the troughs, one will be able to find out the total distance between the sensor, total distance between sensor and the object. However, it is relatively easy to know how much the object moved using the difference in the interference of two observations, and by counting the peaks and the troughs included in the difference, this technique is called interferometry. Now, the height variation between two points target or movements of point targets causes an equivalent change in the phase difference between the same points in the focused complex image couple obtained by two SAR instruments operating under the proper condition. So using two SAR imagery collected with the same SAR geometric configuration, one will be able to find out the elevation information or the movement of the point targets also. So there are other applications, and we will see there are in the next slides the along track and the across track interferometric technique. This is the interferometric SAR. So two SAR images are required. Both the images should be collected with the same SAR geometry. Here you can see the first SAR image is collected by the sensor with particular or fixed look angle and for one particular area in one imaging mode. The second image should be collected in the same imaging mode by the same sensor and separated by a distance, and this distance will be known as baseline. The distance between the platforms during two acquisitions will be known as baseline. So here we can see with the help of two SAR images will be representing the interaction of electromagnetic waves, and these are the coherent images, and finally they will be having the information of amplitude and phase. On the basis of that, one can extract the phase difference also. there are two imaging modes. Monostatic SARs interferometry and the bistatic SAR interferometry. In monostatic SAR interferometry, there will be a temporal gap. There will be a time difference between the two equations. Like one image will be collected during first pass. That will be known as the master image. And the second image with the same geometrical configuration will be collected after revisit, during revisit time after certain days. For an example, for radar set 2, revisit time or repeat time is 24 days, and for ALOS pulsar it is 46 days. So if a repeat time is 24 days, it means that the SAR satellite will collect the interferometric pair after 24 days. If it is 46 days, definitely interferometric pair will be collected at the time difference of 46 days. Radar waves are bounced off the surface on two separate passes, definitely. This is the general phenomena of SAR waves, like SAR sensors transmit electromagnetic waves and collecting the information of the backscattered electromagnetic wave from the Earth objects. And now phase difference resolve the elevation change the fraction of the radar wavelength. So we will be seeing in the next slides how to extract the information of elevation and the displacement using the phase difference. This is the bistatic SAR interferometry. So in bistatic SAR interferometry, it is possible like one SAR sensor will be the transmitter, and there will be it is possible that receiver will be two. So here we can see that this sensor is transmitting the electromagnetic wave, and both are behaving as a receiver. So this electromagnetic wave will be received by the two receivers or two sensors, and baseline will be there. That will be representing the difference of in the position or location of the platforms. That will be the baseline. But in bistatic mode, both the satellites will be collecting the imagery in single pass. There will be no need of repeat pass. And in space borne, Tandem X is the first bistatic SAR mission, and is found by adding a second almost identical spacecraft to TerraSAR X and flying the two satellites in a closely controlled formation with typical distances between 250 and 500 meters. So this is the currently only satellite working in the bistatic mode, but using aircraft sensors, it is possible to do the bistatic SAR interferometry. Otherwise, except Tandem X and TerraSAR, all the satellites are working in monostatic mode. Types of SAR interferometry: along track and across track. Interferometers are used for topographic measurement when the antenna are separated in the cross track direction. Like topographic measurement, either we can consider the case of elevation or the deformation in the Earth surface, or shift in the Earth surface due to earthquake. Now, and interferometers are used to measure line of sight motion when the antenna are separated in the along track direction. So in along track direction, it is very easy to find out the movement of any object. And in across track direction, it is very easy to find out the information of elevation and the displacement. A single antenna repeating its path can form an interferometer to measure the long-term deformation. Like if one is very interested to extract the information deformation occurred in a long time period, though definitely one should use the long-term or you can say long temporal gap of the interferometric pair, then definitely they will be able to find out the difference. Now here we can see cross-track interferometry. So this is an example. Both will be separated by a distance. Both the paths will be separated by a distance. Dual antenna single pass interferometry is also possible, and single antenna repeat pass interferometry is also possible, and this will be sensitive for topographic and the topography and the deformation. Now in along track interferometry, dual antenna single pass interferometry, and along track separation will be there. Finally, they will be sensitive for the radial velocity. In interferometrics are either there will be bistatic mode or repeat pass mode, but during the image acquisition, both the platforms or the same platform during two acquisitions must be separated by a distance, and this is known as a baseline. Here this is the baseline represented by B, and BN is representing the perpendicular baseline. In SAR interferometry, perpendicular baseline is more authentic than normal baseline. So most of the authors they are using, or most of the scientists they are using, normal baseline component in their calculation. And if you will see, for during image acquisition, if both the satellites are targeting one particular object, so suppose the R is the distance between SAR sensor to the target, it is the range distance. Definitely during second time acquisition, either there will be increase in the total distance, range distance, or there will be decrease. So that increase or decrease or change is represented by delta R. So second pass is represented, second pass range distance is represented by R plus delta R. And now here generally two layers, ionosphere and troposphere, are there, which are affecting the propagation of electromagnetic wave. So we will be exploring the effect of ionosphere and troposphere during differential SAR interferometry discussion. The phase of SAR image, if one will have the information of R, we know the range information for each and every pixel. Range information means range distance for each and every pixel is collected in the terms of nanoseconds, we have already seen. So for each and every pixel, one can easily generate the phase image. So that will be approximately equals to 4 pi R divided by lambda. Here we can see. So 2 pi by lambda multiplied by 2R, because there is a two-way propagation. So the radiation transmitted from the radar has to reach the scatterer on the ground and then come back to the radar in the order to form the SAR image. This is the two-way travel, two-way propagation of electromagnetic wave. Finally, this will be the 4 pi by lambda multiplied by R. So in the synthetic phase generation part, we will be focusing to generate the synthetic phases of the interferogram using this technique. Now baseline. The baseline length is the distance between the SAR satellite orbits for the first and second observation. Here you can see B is the baseline, the distance between the platforms during two image acquisition. In INSAR, the vertical component or perpendicular component, sometimes we are also seeing perpendicular, along the line of sight is more important than the baseline B. This vertical component of the baseline B along the line of sight is referred to as B perpendicular. Here it, you can see the perpendicular component from the first pass to the second pass. This is the perpendicular component, and we will be trying to extract the information of normal component of baseline. Now there is a relation in normal component and simple baseline. So if you will see, orthogonal baseline component B perpendicular is key parameter used in the INSAR analysis. So here if you will see, if theta is the look angle and alpha is the angle between one, alpha is the angle between the baseline, alpha is the angle between the perpendicular baseline and one horizontal line drawn in the line of sight towards A1. So if you will see, this is the alpha. Alpha is the angle between the baseline and the line of sight along the first pass, that will be A1. So B perpendicular will be B cos theta minus alpha. So this is the relation between B perpendicular and the normal baseline component and the horizontal baseline component. Now this is the geometry. If you will see carefully, baseline decorrelation, here we will be talking about the baseline decorrelation. Definitely to generate interferogram there is need of the baseline, but definitely if the baseline will be very large, then also there will be difficulty to generate interferogram, because there will be complete loss of correlation, or the both the or the surface or objects appearing in the two acquisition will be completely changed during two acquisitions. If the baseline will be very large, objects will be same, but due to very large baseline, they will be appearing as different objects. There will not be possible to generate interferogram. So using the simple approach we have seen previously, the interferometric phase, suppose we are talking about the pixel 1 and 2, there are two pixels, and pixel 1 and 2 on a surface with slope beta. So here we can see beta is the angle which is representing the slope. So for the first pixel, the phase will be a 2 pi divided by lambda b sine theta minus alpha, where a will be 1 for bistatic mode, and it will be 2 for the monostatic mode, because two way travel of electromagnetic wave will be there. So finally it will be for bistatic mode it will be 4 pi by lambda. And similarly for the second pixel, there is a difference of delta theta in the look angle. So here you can see for the second pixel it becomes a 2 pi divided by lambda multiplied by b sine theta plus delta theta minus alpha. So finally for a small slant range resolution, one can easily find out the value of phi 2, and on the basis of that one can easily find out the phase difference during two acquisitions. Now here in the next slide we will see the critical baseline. So critical baseline, when there will be complete decorrelation, the critical baseline is the aperture separation perpendicular to the look direction at which the interferometric correlation becomes zero. So finally there will be complete decorrelation. So there it will not be possible to generate interferogram when the baseline will be beyond the critical baseline. So one should always prefer the data set under which is lying under critical baseline. Otherwise, if it will be beyond the critical baseline, then it will not be possible to generate interferogram. So here the perpendicular component of critical baseline will be equals to the normal component of critical baseline multiplied by cos theta minus phi, and finally this will be the expression, and beta perpendicular denotes the perpendicular component of the baseline. Here rho r is the slant range resolution. A in this case, or like in the case of monostatic system, A will be 2, and here beta is representing the slope. If both the pixels are lying in the flat terrain, then definitely this beta will become 0. So finally the formula will be lambda r naught multiplied by tan theta divided by 2 rho r, where r naught is the total distance from the sensor to the object. Now altitude of ambiguity. Altitude of ambiguity is defined with the BN. Here we will see the altitude of ambiguity is defined as the altitude difference that generate an interferometric phase change of 2 pi after interferogram flattening. The altitude of ambiguity is inversely proportional to the perpendicular baseline. Then definitely to extract the elevation information, one should always prefer the larger baseline. Here we can see, if we will have the larger baseline, there will be less ambiguity in the height estimation. If beta n will be less, then definitely the ambiguity in height HA will be more. Like here one example taken from the ESA interferometric manual. So in the ERS case with lambda equals to 5.6 centimeter, theta equals 23, and r equals to 850 kilometer, so ambiguity in height will be approximately 9300 divided by BN, normal component of baseline. If you will see, if a 100 meter perpendicular baseline is used, a 2 pi change of the interferometric phase corresponds to an altitude difference of about 93 meters. Then definitely, if you will be selecting the interferometric pair of large baselines, large perpendicular baseline, then definitely this ambiguity will be less. For an example, say for 1000 meter baseline, the ambiguity in height will become approximately 9.3 meter. But we should also take care, like for elevation information extraction, so baseline should not be very less. If it will be approximately near to zero, then also it will be very difficult to generate SAR interferogram. To minimize the ambiguity in height, one should always select the larger baselines between two interferometric SAR pairs. We should also take care the selected baseline should not be larger than the critical baseline. Otherwise, we will not be able to generate interferogram. Interferogram generation, simply this is the Hermitian product of master and slave images. Here, if you will see, the interferogram is generated by the pixel-to-pixel competition of the Hermitian product of the two co-registered images, which are already spectral shift filtered. So here we will see CM is representing the pixel value, complex pixel value of master image, and CS is representing the complex conjugate of the slave. So this product, like complex value of 1 pixel of master image will be multiplied with the complex conjugate of the corresponding pixel in the slave image. This complex multiplication is known as the Hermitian product or Hermitian multiplication. So finally, it will be generating another image with the complex values, that will be the interferogram. So here we can see from this figure. So this is the image captured during first pass. This is the image captured during the second pass. So finally, the complex multiplication of Hermitian products provide an interferogram. We can see the fringe patterns. But we are not able to analyze anything because fringes are sometimes representing the change in the elevation. If these fringes will be, if there will be the fringe contribution due to the topography or on the basis of topography, there will be a change in the elevation. So finally, there will be change in the fringes also. From this raw interferogram, we are not able to make any statement. And this is the same interferogram after flattening, so one will be able to make some interpretation on the basis of the flattened interferogram. Now, this is the interferogram of Fujiyama Mountain of Japan. The data set is freely available, so I process this data set to generate an interferogram. So the ALOS pulsar data in fine beam dual polarization mode. So first image, or we can say master image, is of 1st July 2007, and the slave image is 16th August 2007. So here we can see, if you will see the real imagery of the Fujiyama mountain. So here we will get very high altitude. This is the Fujiyama mountain. So very high altitude will be there. And the fringes, we can see that very narrow circular fringes are there. And for water body, we will not have any fixed pattern of the fringes. Sometimes it will also appear dark. And on the basis of the fringes, one will be able to convert the phase difference of the interferogram to the height, and one will get the information of elevation. Now, this is the DEM generated from the previous data set of the Fujiyama mountain. So for each and every elevation difference, we have different fringes, electromagnetic, fringes of interferogram. So here we can easily see the change in the elevation. So here there is very high elevation, and finally there is flat elevation, there is water body, and here we will be getting the mixed type of fringes due to the appearance of urban area. Now this is the 3D visualization of the DM using color background of Landsat TM dataset. So here this is representing the water body appearing as black, and just took the color composite of Landsat TM data on the DM. We are able to see the clear picture. Now, these are the contour lines generated from the DM, and they are just shown and above the digital elevation model. Here we can see, and there will be not a clear pattern in the sea surface. Here we can easily see. Now we will see the interferometric analysis of Hathi earthquake. Now, and after that, we will be seeing the interferometric data processing also. So Hathi is located at the boundary between the Caribbean plate and the North America plate. So in 2010, there was one earthquake, very heavy earthquake due to the plate movement. So here we will see. Now this is the interferogram generated using 9th March 2009 data and 25th January 2010 data set. So here you can see the different fringes. So one will be able to make some analysis on the basis of these fringes. Now the same data set, if you will see, the area of many contours near the city of Lugan shows an area of the surface uplift caused by the fault motion at depth. This interferogram shows that main earthquake rupture did not reach the surface on land. So if you will see the rectangle in the figure shows the location and length of the earthquake rupture zone along the boundary. The red star indicates the epicenter. The rupture extended about 35 kilometers, 22 miles. So due to the plate movement, there was uplift in the surface. So we are able to find out the change in the surface using the SAR interferometry. So detailed analysis is available on the NASA website. Now we will coming to the INSAR data processing. So two applications we have already seen. One was related to elevation information extraction. Another was related to the deformation mapping and you can say shift in the earth surface or shift in the location of the same objects during two acquisitions. One can easily measure those changes. Now in INSAR image processing, first we will have the SLC data pair. Then from the SLC data pair, one can extract the baseline information so that you will have a surety that this data set can be used for interferometric application or not. If it will be beyond then the critical baseline, then definitely you should use another data set for interferometric application. Then both the data sets will be co-registered, and finally both will be the multi-looked, and the synthetic phase generation will be there for the SLC data pair. And finally, interferogram will be generated using the Hermitian product of the two SLC images. And if there will be need, then one can also do the interferogram flattening. Then finally, adaptive filtering and the coherence image generation. Adaptive filtering will be there to remove the unwanted noise from the data set. And the coherence image generation, it will be showing the complex correlation coefficient between the two images during two acquisitions. And finally, phase unwrapping will be there to unwrap the phase of the interferogram. And finally, one can estimate the phase information. And finally, that phase can be used for height retrieval as well as for the displacement retrieval. Now this is the same processing step: co-registration, multi-look processing, baseline estimation, synthetic phase generation, interferogram flattening, adaptive filtering and the coherence generation, and the phase unwrapping. Co-registration of the SAR images. SAR interferometry requires pixel-to-pixel match between the common features in SAR image pairs. Thus, co-registration, the alignment of the SAR images from one antenna is an essential step for the accurate determination of the phase difference and for noise reduction. Here, during two image acquisition from the either same SAR sensor or the in biostatic mode. For an example, say in monostatic case in the repeat pass, if the two images were acquired, so definitely there will be some shift. There will be some shift in the location, in the position. Either sometimes if it will be very precise, then definitely there will be shift of 1 pixel or 2 pixel. Sometime more than that. Sometime it will shift will be more than the 100 pixel also. So there is need of co-registration so that we will be providing the capacity or potential to the software to identify the exact location of the pixels appearing in both the images. So, for an example, we can understand like that. Like 1 pixel captured during first pass, it might be possible that in the second pass, the location of the first pixel, like location of first pixel is object A. So it is also possible, sometimes it is possible that the location of object B in the which is appearing in the first pixel during first image acquisition or in the first image will appear at third pixel or fourth pixel in the second image. So like if we are doing direct multiplication of the direct Hermitian product without co-registration, then definitely finally there will not be any information. So here in the co-registration, we are providing the information to the software, we are providing potential to the software to extract the information of the different objects and their corresponding location in the second image. And finally, on the basis of that, software will be able to find out the exact location of the same feature appearing in the two acquisitions. Now, multi-look processing we have already seen. This is the Inviset SR SLC image, and this is for the image was acquired for Dudhwa National Park. So here we can easily see the linear feature. Linear feature, this is appearing as dark feature. So multi-look in SLC image, we are not able to clearly identify. Now we are not able to clearly see, but after doing the multi-looking, because coverage is very large, swath is very large, so after doing multi-look processing, we are able to see the different objects. Now, in the baseline estimation, baseline estimation gives the information about the baseline values and the orbital shift by using the relevant master and slave data. Following information is obtained after baseline estimation process. First one will be normal baseline, second is the critical baseline, range shift, and the azimuth shift. We can see, like I estimated the baseline information for ALOS Pulsar of Fujiyama data set. If you will see ALOS Pulsar data set captured for the Fujiyama mountain, so your normal baseline component is 272.294 meter. Critical baseline for this data is approximately 6526, and the shift in range direction is 1.14. definitely this data set is of very good quality, because here shift is approximately 1.1. We can say less than 2 pixel. Shift is less than 2 pixel in range and azimuth both the directions. Temporal gap is of 46 days. Then the next step was synthetic phase generation. Yeah, definitely if you have the information of the range, that will be the distance from sensor to object. So for each and every pixel, we can create the synthetic phase. So phase expected for a flat earth or non-topography is extracted. In the process of synthetic phase generation, phase value is estimated from the formula given here, 4 pi by lambda multiplied by RM minus RS, where RM and RS as the master and slave satellite distance for a particular object in both the images. Interferogram. Interferogram is generated by the Hermitian product for pixel-to-pixel computation of Hermitian product for both the co-registered images, master and slave images. Master will be the image collected during first pass, slave will be the image collected during the second pass. So after doing that, we will be getting the interferogram. So here we can see Okay, sorry, there was some these PPT images are heavy, so that we were not able to see. Now we are able to see interferogram generation. So by after doing the complex multiplication, we will be able to generate the interferogram. Now interferogram flattening is the process in which the fringe and the phase effects due to the shape of the earth ellipsoid have been removed. A flattened interferogram contains only the fringe edge contributed by the topographic terrain. Flattening involves the removal of the low frequency phase difference from the interferogram, and it also removes the systematic phase difference arises due to the difference in the partition of the two antennas. So here we will see. Now these are the two images. The two images are collected using the ALOS pulsar sensor. So if you will see, this is the raw interferogram generated with the help of complex multiplication Hermitian product, pixel to pixel product of Hermitian of the co-registered. These images are co-registered images, and finally we will be getting, if you will zoom it, here we are able to get some pattern, interferometric pattern. If you will see, interferometric patterns are visible, but not fixed pattern is appearing. So finally we did interferogram flattening. So after doing the interferogram flattening, we are able to see the different patterns or different fringes which are there due to the contribution of topography. So on the basis of that, one can make some analysis. Now this is the flattened interferogram generated using ALOS pulsar data for the Doon Valley. So one data set is of 16 June 2010 and another data set was of 1st August 2010. So here we can easily see for the different topographic variations, we are able to see the for each and every elevation change, there are different fringes. Here we can see the fringes. So each fringe is appearing as a contour lines. Finally, there will be different fringe for different elevation information. Now, filtering of flattened interferogram smooths the interferometric phase and therefore reduce noise. A spectral shift filter used in the processing of interferogram provides capacity to generate a better quality of interferogram. We will see what is the effect of adaptive filtering in the flattened interferogram in the next slide. Now this is the interferogram generated after adaptive filtering. Now the unwanted noise is removed. If you will see, if you will compare both the images, this is the interferogram, flattened interferogram generated before filtering, and this is the interferogram generated after filtering. So one can easily find out that like here in this area, and if you will see the cursor, and for this location, now the systematic fringes are appearing, and one can easily remove the unwanted noise from the SAR interferogram. Now then we will be generating the coherence image. Coherence is simply the complex correlation coefficient. So coherence for the two co-registered SAR images computed using the formula. Formula is given. So this formula is very much similar to the correlation coefficient. So one can easily find out the complex correlation coefficient, and by taking the mod, one will be getting the values between 0 to 1. Now the previous formula was there for flat terrain. So flat ground which does not induce phase is rarely available. So to estimate coherence, it becomes necessary to involve the phase information. So here we can see e to the power minus j phi. This is the phase contributed by the topography of the earth surface. So this is also included to find out the reliable coherence information from the SAR data set. Now in the coherence image, so in coherence image, coherence is complex correlation coefficient, so it will be showing the correlation between two features appearing in the images during two acquisitions. So for permanent scatterers, like if there will not be any change in the surface, coherence will be very high, and if there will be change in the surface, So coherence will be low. Like in the case of water body, so water surface surface of water body is changing at hourly basis. So definitely after two pass or during two pass, there will be complete change in the surface. So finally one will not be able to get the coherence value. Finally that will be appearing darker. So in the next slide we will see the coherence image generated for the same area. So here we can see for the permanent scatterers, these are appearing very, very bright, and the portion which are appearing dark are not permanent permanent scatterers. So that the surface is not same during two equations. So finally, this water body is appearing dark. Now this is the comparison of the backscatter image and the coherence image. In backscatter image, smooth surfaces will be appearing dark because no information will be returned back. This is the backscatter image and coherence image, coherence image generated from the Envisat SR dataset. Now here we can see this patch is appearing dark, so one can say that it is possible that we will be confused that this is ground or water. Yeah, definitely in water, in the case of water also, like this location, this will also appear dark. And this is in dense forest, so we are getting some bright pattern, but these are the smooth surfaces, so we are getting the very dark patch. Now in the coherence image, this is not a very smooth surface, little bit rough surface. So here we can get that these are appearing very bright because these are the permanent scatterer and the coherence is high in this case. So we are able to get some information, and finally on the basis of that one can make analysis. No, this is not water body. Now phase unwrapping, adding the correct multiple of 2 pi to the interferometric phase for each pixel. It refers to the conversion from measured phase to the absolute phase. The phase estimates contained by the interferogram are wrapped in 0 to 2 pi because we have already seen either minus pi to plus pi. So here we are saying that 0 to 2 pi. So phase unwrapping will be, unwrapped phase will be equals to wrapped phase multiplied, and it is summed by 2 pi n, where n an integer representing number of cycles to unwrap the phase of the single pixel. Now for an example, this is an example taken in wrapped phase, like in interferogram without phase unwrapping. So phase of any elevated area that will be appearing like this, because from 0 to 2 pi, 0 to 2 pi, 0 to 2 pi, and 0 to 2 pi, 8 pi. Now phase unwrapping, we will be extend the phases, 4 phases in 0 to 2 pi, and finally it will be given as the actual profile, that will be 0 to finally it will become the 8 pi, and same will happen with the opposite side. Now this is the interferogram after phase unwrapping, so we will be able to find out the actual fringe, and from that one will be able to find out the height information also. So now in the next slide we will see this formula. There are different approaches. So here one approach is utilized. Most of the softwares are utilizing this approach to convert the height from the phase difference. So formula used is for interferometric center. The formula will be lambda r sine theta divided by 4 pi bn multiplied by the phase difference. So this is the delta phi measured, that is the phase difference and representing the interferometric phase, that will be the phase difference of the two SAR images. And finally it will be multiplied with the wavelength, and again multiplied with the range distance, and with the sine of the angle of incidence, and divided by 4 pi multiplied by the normal baseline component, and this will provide the information of the height of the object. Now this is the height generated from the interferometric pair of the Las Pulsar data we have seen previously. Now again this is the 3D view. The contour lines are shown above the DM. So here this is the 3D view generated from the previous data set, previous digital elevation model. Now there are sources of decorrelations. So first source, first is we have already seen baseline decorrelation. Yeah, definitely baseline should not be greater than the critical baseline, and definitely Doppler centroid decorrelation. Definitely the data we should have the information of the Doppler centroid. Definitely there will be occur, this will occur as decorrelation. volume decoration. This will be due to the scattering from the forest area in the nature, or scattering from the vegetation in the SAR imagery, that will cause the volume decorrelation. Thermal decorrelation or system noise, definitely due to the thermal heat, it is also possible it will affect the quality of the SAR image, but now most of the sensors are nowadays free from the thermal decorrelation. Temporal terrain decorrelation, yeah, we cannot do anything with the temporal terrain decorrelation. Because definitely there will be decorrelation in the terrain, then only we are able to find out some changes. Otherwise, if there will be no change, no decorrelation. Processing induced decorrelation, if there will be mismatching in the identification of the pixels during co-registration, then definitely that will be cause decorrelation. And finally, we will not be able to get the correct SAR interferogram. Now the total decorrelation will be the multiplication of all the decorrelations here we can see. These are the few space-bound SAR satellites, and revisit time is also given. So for ERS 1 and 2, repeat pass time was 3-5 days, and in tandem mode, the repeat pass was 24 hours, one day interval. Now for JERS, repeat pass was 46 days, and radar set 1, repeat pass was 24 days. For Invisat SR, repeat pass was 35 days. For ALOS Pulsar, repeat pass was 46 days. For radar set 2, repeat pass is 24 days, and for TerraSAR X alone, it is 11 days, but in the biostatic mode, at the same time also, one can collect the data set. Now, revisit time, repeat pass, this is representing like after 35 days or 46 days, whatever there for the particular satellites, satellites will collect the same data set, collect the data set for the same area with the same geometric configuration. Now one can select the data set according to the need, like for the glaciological application, then definitely the data set will be different. For agriculture application, definitely there will be temporal gap at the weekly interval. If there will not be weekly interval, then definitely there will be very big change. Then one will not be able to identify the growth or change in the agriculture patch. Now, so definitely tomorrow we will try to discuss about the different applications. Now, shortcoming of the terrestrial sensor. So definitely it is affected by the ground condition and affected by the atmosphere. So atmospheric application we will be seeing in the next differential interferometric in the next classes. Now, if SAR interferograms, if both the data sets or interferometric pairs were collected for very dense vegetated area, then definitely there will be very high volume scattering, then the decorrelation will also be very high from the volume scattering, and that will be finally known as the volume decorrelation, and one will not be able to generate the correct interferogram. Now, INSAR does not work well for sites disturbed too much. Definitely, if that will be completely disturbed, then complete decorrelation, finally we will not be able to generate for that location. INSAR does not work in steep terrain, yeah, definitely due to the layover foreshortening and shadow effect, we will not be able to generate the interferogram for the steep terrains. Now, INSAR does not work if the surface measured is too smooth. It definitely, like in the case of water body, that is very smooth, we will not be getting the interferometric pattern or interferometric fringes for very smooth surfaces. INSAR does not work if the area is too small. Definitely, like to find out the interferometric pattern, we should select some bigger area, or it depends on sometimes resolution also. So definitely, our study area should not be very small. Now, there are different applications. This is related to the application in forestry. One more modeling approach, two modeling approach, water cloud and interferometric water cloud. Both are using the coherence and backscatter values, coherence values from the SAR image. We have already seen how to generate the coherence images. So using the coherence values, one will be able to do some modeling approach for biomass and stem volume estimation using interferometric water cloud modeling, and other model approaches are also there. And using the interferometric applications, one can also measure the tree height. Now, glaciological applications are also there to understand well the dynamics of glacier and the physical mechanism of motion of ice stream and ice sheet. Accurate measurement of displacement, the subsequent velocity field of glacier and ice shelves are important because they provide a better knowledge of the parameters that control the flow of glacier and the ice shelf. Definitely, using the very short time interval of interferometric pairs, interferometric passes, one can easily find out the glacier moment that will be providing reliable information. On the basis of that, one can measure the total shift or total movement occurred in the top glacier surface. Now, other applications of INSAR are very broad. Here, few more applications are there in agriculture also. I have not included in this slide. In seismology, land surface deformation due to earthquakes. In nature, disaster monitoring and assessment, volcanoes and landslide movement. And lava movement also, in lava movement of volcano also can be measured. In surface water hydrology, water level monitoring, snow accumulation, that can also be monitoring is possible for snow accumulation zone also. In glaciology, ice sheet motion, glacier flow, post-glacier rebound of the lithosphere, and in mining, land subsidence due to mining. In forestry, definitely canopy height, mapping monitoring, biomass estimation and modeling approaches. In environment and the structural engineering, ground subsidence and the structural stability. Now these are the few books on the microwave remote sensing. Like one can extract the detailed information of microwave remote sensing, SAR interferometry, and SAR remote sensing using these books. Thank you. One question, what is